The name Of our lips before the throne, that we would bring, Lord, the sacrifice of our lives, that we would be a living sacrifice,
yes,
holy, acceptable unto you, Lord, which is only reasonable. We come, Lord, and we give you our all. Father, and if we're not prepared to do that, I pray that you would speak to us,
yes,
through this service.
Yes.
Pray, God, you would open our eyes. I ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would come and move in this place in such a way, Lord God, that you wake up those that slumber.
Yes.
You open the eyes of the blind. God, that you get the attention of those who are idle here, there, God, wherever this message may go. Father God, we need to see, we need to understand, we need to be awakened, we need to be alert, we need to be watchful. We need to come, Lord God, and be the holy vessels with a holy, living hope that you have given us. Pray, God, that you would stir our hearts this morning. That you would bring us, Father, to the altar. You would bring us to a place of consecration. God, I ask that you would be glorified, that you would have your way, that your Holy Spirit would permeate this place and anoint me, I pray, Father,
yes,
for the preaching of your word. We ask it in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
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 You may be seated.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you for being here this morning.
Amen. Praise God.
The Lord's day, the Lord's house, the Lord's people gathered.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. To glorify the Lord.
Yes.
Magnify his name and to hear from him. That's what we're doing here this morning. Reverend Mark A. Sharnick Sr. is preaching the gospel. But you didn't come to hear the preacher. You came to hear from God. You came to hear what the Lord would say to us this morning through his word.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Amen. That's all we have. We have his word. And so we look to his word this morning with our hearts open to receive. Yes. What would it matter if we came to hear his word if our hearts weren't open to receive it?
Yes.
That would be a waste of time, wouldn't it? Yes. Waste of time, waste of energy, a mockery of the things of God. But we've come this morning, our hearts open.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
If not, I would ask you to bow your head right there before we go any further and say, God, please open my heart. Yes. Open my understanding. Yes. Soften my heart. Soften my spirit. I need to hear from you, Lord. I know you're talking to me today, and God, I need you.
Yes.
So I'm here to hear from you.
Amen.
How desperately we need to hear from the Lord this morning.
That's right.
I'm going to be reading from Hebrews chapter 6, just a few verses. You could turn to Hebrews if you want, or you could just follow along with me. Just listen. I promise I won't lie. I'll read from the Bible. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 17 through 19. Wherein God willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge, to lay hold upon the hope set before us, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Title of my message is My Anchor Holds. We talked about hope last week. I shared with you how important it is to have hope. And hope is rooted in our faith. Faith looks back to what God has done, and from it springs hope, which looks forward. We talked about how our hope is not in a new year necessarily. It's our hope is in Jesus Christ alone. I want to continue in that same theme today regarding our hope in Christ. Now, I've preached from this text countless times. Maybe you recall, it's a basis for one of my funeral messages that I preached several times. But this verse, this portion of Scripture came to mind this past week while in prayer. I felt that the Lord impressing this upon me, speaking to me about this, and so I will share it with you this morning. My anchor holds. I love that. There's several hymns, several songs that the church sings. My Anchor Holds is a hymn. It's not in our hymn, though, but it's an old hymn talking about just that. We have an anchor that is sure and steadfast. And then there's another song, The Anchor Holds, probably more familiar. Beautiful words talking about this very topic, that we have a hope in Christ, an anchor for our souls, both sure and steadfast. Now, hope is a gift that God has given us that is indispensable. We need hope. And by the way, if you say amen at any point in time in the service, I will know that you heard it. It was recorded, and that you're willing to act upon it. It will also encourage me to continue to preach. Amen. You know, you've heard me say many times before, saying amen to a Pentecostal preacher is like saying sick 'em to a bulldog. So just sit me. A hope is a gift from God that is indispensable. This world has become virtually hopeless.
Amen.
I don't think I need to tell you that.
Uh-huh.
So let me lay out some statistics here. June 2020, CDC released data suggesting that one in four adults ages 18 to 24 have considered suicide. The same year, September 2020, 48% of Americans overall suffered from depression. 48 Americans overall, all age groups. May 2021, a Harvard poll suggests that 51% of young Americans say they feel down, depressed, or hopeless. Professor Ellen Mira of Princeton University called it the epidemic of hopelessness. Now, that's all understandable, given that this time frame, 2020, 2021, it was all in that time of the pandemic, the COVID-19, the shutdown, lockout, social distancing, distance learning, all of that was going on, and it's understandable that people would be depressed in those times. Certainly understandable. But according to the poll by the Institute of Politics at Harvard Kennedy School in the spring of 2023, it's no better. That's right. And there's no indication that it's going to get any better in 2024. Mm-hmm. But, hear me, but we have an abundant hope, abundant supply of hope in Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear me, an abundant supply.
Hallelujah.
Listen, we're talking statistics, we're talking about the world's numbers, but we, listen to Romans 15, 13, the Apostle Paul writing to that church, he says, now the God of hope, he is the God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. I just got to read that again. Listen. Receive this. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
That word abound means to overflow, to exceed the limits, to be superfluous. So Paul is, he's praying and he's saying that God, the God of hope, will fill you with joy, all peace, and with a super abundance of overflowing joy.
Amen.
Listen, man.
Praise God.
Whatever the numbers are out there, we have an abundant supply of overflowing hope available to us in Christ
Amen.
Jesus.
Praise God.
Thank you.
See, the problem is our understanding. Problem is understanding. Our understanding is faulty. How many times do we misunderstand? It is fallen. It's part of our fallen nature, and it's frail. Our understanding is fragile. It's frail. It's fallen. The Proverbs in chapter 3, verses 5 and 6 say this. In light of that, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
Amen.
There are many things we don't understand, and I've said so many times before. The more I learn, the less I know. And the more I think I understand, the less I truly do understand. There's many things that we do not understand. Human understanding and the reliance upon human understanding is called humanism. And humanism is just that. It's a reliance on our own fragile, fallen, faulty understanding. Listen, we rely on our human understanding to answer all the questions. How's that working? See, human understanding or humanism says, if I can't understand it, it doesn't exist. There can't be a God. None of these things can be true. It's all fallacy because I don't understand. If you can't explain it to me, if I don't see scientific proof and evidence for it, then I disregard it. It can't possibly be. If I don't understand it, then it can't be true. That's really the essence of humanism, our faulty understanding. The world, the unbelieving world, relies on circular reasoning. You know what circular reasoning is? They start where they want to end up. That's circular reasoning. Here, there is no God, and this is why. And so they all draw from the same polluted pool of unbelief for their evidence. There is no God, and this is why. Because there's a big bang. You know, there was nothing.
Guess what?
When nothing was forever, but ever didn't exist because there was nothing. Okay. There was a big bang that came from nowhere, from nothing, when, at a time when there was no time, in a place where there was no place, nothing. And the Big Bang theory is true. There is no God because the Big Bang theory is true. You say, well, how do you know the Big Bang theory is true?
True.
Well, because thousands of scientists over many decades have studied and concluded that evolution is real, and there is no proof for creation, so the Big Bang theory is true, and there is no God, because the scientists all have studied, and scientists are well educated. And so they, for all of them, for decades, have concluded the same thing, that there is no God, the Big Bang theory is true, evolution is true, and their conclusions will always be the same. Because they start with this very premise that there is no God. And because all the studies have, all the educated scientists have said that there is no God, there is no God. You get this circular reasoning. And the conclusion will always be the same, because they're drawing from the same pool of faulty evidence and reasoning. In all fairness, religion can be considered circular reasoning as well. Christianity could be considered by the world as circular reasoning as well, because we say the Bible is true. Why is the Bible true? Because the Bible tells us it's true. And you say, well, that's not a valid argument. That's true. That's not a valid argument. Although I believe it with all my heart and soul, that's not a reasonable argument in trying to convince the world. You follow me? Because we would be doing the same thing that they do. Time out. If you want arguments for the truth of the Bible, Josh McDowell, anything he's ever written, evidence, write this down, evidence that demands a verdict, more evidence that demands a verdict, More Than a Carpenter, Ken Ham, Answers in Genesis, Norman Geisler, Christian Apologetics, any Christian apologetics. By the way, apologetics is the study of proof and evidence and argument for the existence of God. Just tell you, Charles Greenaway, one of my professors, he said, they wanted me to learn apologetics in Bible college. I'm not apologizing for anything, he said. Apologetics is not an apology. It's the study of defending the truth. But this message today is not a study in apologetics. All right, so understand. This is why faith is so important. Because we say we're doing the same thing the world is doing when we say the Bible is true because the Bible tells us it's true. That's circular reasoning as well. But if we have faith, we have faith, and I can tell you we have evidence because we have changed lives. It works.
Amen.
But this is why faith is so incredibly important, especially as we're talking about hope. Remember what I said last week. Hope stems from faith. Hope comes out of faith. And so we need to look. Faith is so important. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. You still with me?
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. The Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I'm not going to go through the whole study of all the words, but listen. Faith is the substance. Substance, that's two words, sub and stance, right? Yep. Substance. Sub is under, and stance is standing. So you have two words, standing under. So faith stands under everything. It is the substance. It is the foundation. It is foundational to everything else. It is the beginning of everything else that we know, trust, believe, hope in. Faith is the undergirding, the foundation of the foundation, if you will, of everything else. The every hope we have stands on faith. And it is the evidence being proof. Now listen to this. Faith is the proof of things unseen. Now you say, well, Pastor, you're talking in circles here. Where's the evidence? There's no evidence. You're talking about faith being the evidence, and there's no, you don't have scientific evidence. So what are you talking about proof? What are you talking about evidence? That's what faith is. Faith says, I believe it. It is proof. It is true because of how it has affected my life. I see it. I know it. I believe it more so than anything that I can see with my own eyes. I know this is true. And everything about me, everything I believe, hope, and trust is standing upon this faith. I don't need scientific evidence. I have proof.
Amen.
You with me?
Amen.
My faith, I believe, and I trust, and I know this is to be true. This is the undergirding of everything else. Hebrews 11:6 goes on to say, but without faith, if you don't have that, it is impossible to please God. We can't please God without this proof. This faith in our hearts.
Amen.
Now, the writer of Hebrews says that our hope, this super abundance of hope that we have in Christ, has gone beyond the veil. You still with me? Mm-hmm.
Yes. Amen.
It's quiet in here.
Amen.
Not a lot of people.
We're listening.
Thank you. This faith goes beyond the veil. Now, that veil is beyond what it represents, the earthly realm, right? The veil represents the earthly realm. In the temple of old, the veil in the house of God separated the profane from the holy presence of God. Remember in the picture of, right? The priests nobody could go into the Holy of Holies, the most holy place, the place where God said his presence would dwell. The holy presence of God was separated from the profane, from humanity, from sin by this veil. And it separated the profane from the holy presence of God. It represents that which was hidden from the eyes of mortal man. No man could see into the Holy of Holies. It represented that which was hidden from the eyes of mortal man. Only the high priest, only one time per year, and only with the blood of the sacrifice was allowed beyond the veil. Nobody could go there except for the high priest once a year, and he had to come with the blood of the sacrificial animal. For us, the veil represents this earthly life and beyond. It represents all the things that we cannot see or understand, all the things which are hidden from us. This veil represents to us in this text. Now we know that spiritually the veil no longer stands between us and God. When Jesus died on the cross, the Bible tells us that the veil was torn in two, allowing access into the Holy of Holies by the blood of the sacrificial lamb, the blood of the Lamb of God. But that veil, that which separated mankind from the holy presence of God, is removed. And now through the blood of Jesus Christ, we all have access into that Holy of Holies, beyond the veil, into the very presence of God. So we know that spiritually, that veil has been removed. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
But metaphorically, our understanding is still veiled.
Mm-hmm.
We still can't see God.
That's right.
We can't see heaven. We can't see what's happening in the spiritual realm. And we can't see what God is doing, and we can't see or understand why he's doing what he's doing. There's that veil. But Jesus, our forerunner, has entered into that realm beyond the veil. Remember, our hope is in Christ.
That's right.
Who has gone beyond the veil as an anchor for our souls.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
He's the forerunner. He has secured for us an eternal hope there. Now we can't see. We cannot see and do not need to see what lies beyond that veil. I don't understand. I don't see heaven. I can't see heaven. I don't know what God is doing. I can't see. But I don't need to. I don't need to understand. I don't need to see. Because our faith in Christ is the foundation of our hope, which is anchored in heaven.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I know. And so my faith in Christ gives me hope, which is anchored in heaven. He is the anchor of our soul. In ancient days, ancient seamen had they referred to their strongest anchor on their ship as the sacred anchor. Now they had other anchors. They had smaller anchors, their daily use anchors, if you will, for normal operations, to hold the ship in place during normal storms, perhaps to hold them in place at the harbor. But they had what they referred to as the sacred anchor. It was reserved for absolute emergencies, for last-ditch effort, when all hope was gone. And they called it the sacred anchor, and it was reserved for the last-ditch efforts because it was so heavy that it was virtually impossible to retrieve. Once it went down, it was too heavy to lift up. In fact, they would need to cut the rope to let it go. So it was reserved for absolute emergencies when all else failed. Their hope was in the sacred anchor. Our hope is in Christ, our sacred anchor, who has gone beyond the veil. An anchor like this suggests to me that life is a series of storms requiring such an anchor.
Yes. Amen.
And so the storms come. Hurricanes in our lives, tornadoes, floods. They come and they threaten to blow everything away. They threaten to wash everything away. Hurricanes, tornadoes, floods. Am I making sense to you? The storms of life come and they seem to desire to overwhelm us. And sometimes we feel overwhelmed.
Yes.
So we need an anchor that will hold throughout all the storms of life.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is that anchor. The Bible says that He is our forerunner. A forerunner is one who goes ahead. Remember, Moses sent out 12 spies into the land of Canaan to spy out the land. They misunderstood what God's intention was, and they came back with a bad report, and they were scared. But nonetheless, they were sent as forerunners. Joshua later sent out 2 spies to go into the promised land to set up a beachhead, if you will. Right? They're not... Anyway, in military terms, a forerunner is a person or maybe a platoon that parachutes in behind enemy lines and they establish a beachhead. They establish a footing, an anchor, if you will, behind enemy lines in a military situation. John the Baptist was a forerunner for Christ. He came and he was preaching, prepare the way of the Lord, right? So he came as a forerunner, as one who went ahead to establish the ministry for Christ to come and fulfill. And Jesus is our forerunner. He went ahead of us to establish our inheritance in heaven. A permanent inheritance in heaven.
Amen.
And he went ahead of us as a forerunner to prepare a place in the Father's house. John 14, 1 through 3, he said, let not your heart be troubled. Don't let your heart be overwhelmed. You believe in God, believe also in me, he said. He said, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. He said, if it wasn't true, I would have told you. But I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. He is our forerunner who has gone into the heavenlies to prepare a place for us and to be that anchor. Amen? To anchor our hope in heaven beyond our understanding, beyond what we can see, our anchor in heaven. He's anchored us in heaven beyond what we can see, hear, or perceive. The writer of Hebrews says that hope we have in Christ, that's gone beyond the veil, is both sure and steadfast. Sure means certain, fixed, settled, guaranteed. And steadfast, the word means firm, secure. It means it doesn't let go. Our anchor doesn't let go. You know, you might go out fishing, you might go out in the storms and you throw out your anchor and you hope for the best, but the storms come and they can blow you away, anchor and all. This, our sacred anchor, doesn't let go. It is sure, it is certain, it is fixed, it is settled, it is guaranteed. It doesn't let go.
Amen.
Amen.
Listen, this will become progressively more important as time goes on.
That's right.
Yes.
Amen.
Paul told Timothy, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. That's a process that Paul said was started and it would continue. So, in essence, worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. That's what he means. Progressively, continuously getting worse and worse and worse. And being deceiving and being deceived. Now brace yourself. All is well. But I want to suggest to you a scenario. Okay, this is not a true scenario. But I want to present to you a scenario. What if you came to church and you found out that your pastor decided to have a sex change?
Oh, my goodness.
Well, hang on. I said, brace yourself. Your board were all mobsters. The elder converted to Islam. Your friends all became Mormons. Your entire family were all atheists. MSNBC, CNN, Fox News all showed videos of an alien invasion. They found a tomb. Scientists, archaeologists found a tomb, and they did a DNA study on the bones there, and they traced it back to Jesus. And they found his body in a tomb somewhere in Israel. Archaeological, anthropological, biological proof that the Bible is a myth. And now all this, at this time, World War III has broken out across the planet. Can I get any darker?
No.
Disease X. By the way, just, hey, I got to say this. The WHO is warning, just listen to this. The WHO is warning, preparing the world for disease X. They say it is 20 times more contagious and 20 times more fatal than COVID-19. But it doesn't exist yet. Disease X, 20 times more fatal, but it doesn't exist yet. Or it does somewhere in the world, but we don't know about it. But in the meantime, they are now making vaccinations. They're making, quote unquote, vaccines for disease X that doesn't yet exist, but it's 20 times more fatal. Open your eyes. What?
Amen.
Do you see what's going on?
Yeah.
And so in all of this, imagine all of these things are going on in your life. Listen, here's my point. You need to be able to stand right where you are and say, I believe Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
All of this, everything in the world, everything I know, everything I believe is falling apart. Everybody I've ever trusted and everything I've ever looked to, everything I know is gone.
Jesus.
You need to be able to stand where you are and say, I believe in Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
My anchor my hope. He is gone. This hope in Christ is gone beyond what I can see. He has secured for me a place in heaven beyond what I understand. All of these things, I still believe in Jesus.
Amen.
You can't, yes. I can't say it anymore, any stronger than what I'm saying here. If an angel appeared to you in your prayer time and said, the Bible is a myth, God doesn't exist, none of these things are true. If an angel appeared and told you everything you believe is a lie, you need to say, my Redeemer liveth.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
You need to say, I know in whom I have believed.
Persuaded.
And I am persuaded. That he is able to keep that which I have committed to him against that day.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Listen, I have taken up my cross to follow. I have put my hand to the plow and there's no looking back.
That's right.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
Amen.
No turning back. No turning back.
Amen.
Though none go with me, still, I will follow.
That's right.
If I stand alone, there's no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back.
Oh, amen.
Listen, you need to hold on to Jesus no matter what it takes.
Hallelujah.
You know, if you have to close your eyes to shut out everything else you see.
Oh, that's right.
If you need to put your fingers in your ears to shut out the sound of everything else that you hear. If you need to just isolate yourself. If you just need to shout as loud as you could, I trust in Jesus.
Amen.
And you do it. You need to come to that place that you know, that you know, that you know, that you know, no matter what anybody else does. No matter what. Listen, pardon the personal reference, but I know what I'm talking about. Years ago, I was a young man. I was, years ago. I felt a call. I believe that God was calling me. My pastor confirmed the call. Others confirmed the call of God on my life. And so I put my condominium on the market to sell. I was selling my home. I gave my notice. I was leaving my very good job as a letter carrier for the U.S. Postal Service. I sold my car, had my car up for sale. Everything I had, everything I knew, I was putting aside to go off to the ministry. And I believe God had called me to go to Germany. And so I had my ticket purchased and arrangements made to go to Germany to be a missionary and to learn the word. And this is my calling. And all this time, people are congratulating me. Oh, Mark, on this call of God, oh, we're so happy for you that God's called you. And all of these things are going on. And in the middle of all this, I came under such an incredible attack like nothing I had ever experienced before. Darkness all around me. And no matter what I did, no matter where I went, in prayer, in Bible study, in everything, even while fasting, I kept hearing the enemy telling me, you're crazy. This is all nuts. You're giving up everything to go up. None of this is real. God hasn't called you. God doesn't love you. None of this. You're giving up everything. You're such a fool. You're such an idiot. You're a jerk. And he kept lying. And then ultimately he kept telling me, God doesn't even exist. Now I'm hearing in my own heart, God doesn't exist. This is all a fallacy. It's all a myth. What are you doing? And I don't remember all the details, but I can tell you this. One night I went into my bedroom and I knelt down at the side of my bed and I was in darkness all around me. And I remember saying something to this effect. God, even if you don't exist, I love you. God, even if you're not real, I praise you. Lord, even if this is all a lie, I worship you. And heaven came down in that room.
Oh, hallelujah.
Like God just wrapped his arms around me. And I felt his presence. And I knew God was just telling me, it's all good. It's all, you're okay, son. It's all good. It's going to be fine. Listen, friends. If your faith has never been tested, it will be. Listen to me. If your faith has never been tested like that, it will be.
Amen.
We need to hold on to Jesus.
Amen.
Right.
Hold on to Jesus.
Yes.
Who's holding whom? Listen, holding on to Jesus is of utmost importance. Grab a hold of him, hold on to that rope that has you securely anchored in heaven, and don't let go. Hold on for dear life. Wrap your arms, your legs around it, grab it with your teeth, and hold on. But who's holding whom? Listen, the Apostle Paul said that he was trying to attain the resurrection. He was reaching forth. He was pressing toward the prize. Remember all that? He was, with everything he had, he was striving to get hold of the prize of his high calling in Christ Jesus. And he goes on, Philippians 3:13. But I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ. He said, I'm trying to lay hold of that which has already laid hold of me. I'm trying to hold on to that which already is holding on to me. Listen, friends, our salvation does not depend on our ability to hold on to Jesus.
Amen.
If it did, we would all fail. If our salvation depended on our own ability to hold on to Christ, we would all fail.
That's right.
Because we're faulty and frail and fallen, and we would let go. It would get too hard. We wouldn't understand, and we would let go. But our salvation does not depend on our ability to hold on to Jesus. Our salvation depends on his ability to hold on to us.
Amen.
Jesus said, and I give them. He knelt and he prayed to his Father. And he said, and I give them eternal life. And they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. You get that?
Amen.
That's a good place to shout. That's a good place to. Jesus said, my Father has given all of them to me, and nobody, nothing could take them from my hand. Nothing could take them from my Father's hand. Friends, God is holding on to us, and none shall pluck us or snatch us from his hand. We need to have that assurance this morning. You know, I love this. This is a song by the Gaithers. See, what it takes is coming to that place. Coming to a place where you have determined that you're going to follow Christ. That you do believe and you're going to trust. And no matter what happens, you're going to listen, it's a Gethsemane, a personal Gethsemane. You know, Jesus knelt in the garden as he prayed. He was facing arrest, beatings, torture, ridicule, mocking, the crucifixion. He was facing taking upon himself the sin of all the world. And there he knelt and said, is there another way? God, Father, is there a way that I could get out of this? Is there a way that your will could be fulfilled and I don't have to do this? And he said, and he realizing, no, this is the very purpose of God, the plan of God. He said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours. He determined that he was going to do the will of the Father, no matter what it looked like, no matter what it sounded like, no matter what anybody else did. We need to have a personal Gethsemane where we kneel down in the presence of God and we determine it's for keeps, that this is I'm laying it all on the altar. You with me?
Amen.
The Gaithers have a song, Have You Had a Gethsemane? I love it. Have you had a Gethsemane? Have you prayed in despair? In the dark of the dreary hour, did the Lord meet you there? Have you had a Gethsemane? Have you prayed the night through? Have you shed tears of agony when no hope was in view? Have you prayed, if it be thy will, may this cup pass for me? But if it's thy will, dear Lord, I will bear it for thee. Listen, friends, We all need to have our own personal Gethsemane.
Amen.
That place where we lay it down on the altar and say, Father, no matter what happens, no matter what the world does, no matter what my friends do, my family, my church, my pastor, my elders, no matter what anybody else does, I am committed to following you. I trust in you. My hope is in Christ alone. If your faith has not been tested, it will be. Let me just ask as I close. Can you stand and say, no matter what, I trust in Jesus?
Yes.
Can you say that?
Amen.
Faith.
Yes.
Forsaking
yes.
all, I trust him.
Yes.
Can you say that? Can you say that? No matter what.
Amen.
Now you could trust in Jesus, or you can lean on your own understanding. Those are the only two options. The only two options God gives us, the only two options that exist. You could say, I will choose to trust in Jesus, or I'm going to try and figure it out on my own. I'm going to listen to all the talking heads, and we'll figure this all out. You have two choices. See, it doesn't matter what I hear, what I see, feel, think, taste, smell. None of it matters. I don't have to understand. You can't understand. It is impossible. No. If you show me the evidence, if you tell me, you know, then I'll look at it. I'll reason out the evidence and I'll decide. No, you can't. You have no understanding of what's going on. None. Only what God reveals.
Amen.
So you can't rely upon your own understanding. You have to be able to say, I don't care. None of this doesn't have to make sense. I know it can't make sense. I'm going to trust in Christ alone.
Amen.
No matter what. I can't emphasize this enough.
Yes.
The real world, the life on planet Earth, has become like a really bad sci-fi movie. Meets a horror flick, meets a comedy. Right? Am I right? Life on planet Earth, it's the weirdest sci-fi movie I've ever seen, only I'm in it. It's a horror flick, because it's scary stuff, and it's so ridiculous, it's comical. I don't know if I should laugh or cry. This is what life has become. None of it makes any sense.
Amen.
Jesus said it will be like this in the days of, it will be like this in the last days, like the days of Noah when he returns for his church. They were living, marrying, partying, living the lives with no regard for God at all. Just going on like everything was just wonderful. And the floods came unexpectedly, and anyone not in the ark was lost. We are living in such days, friends, that are like the days of Noah.
Yes, we are.
Eating and drinking and marrying and going on with life with no regard. While all the time the Bible is warning us of the flood, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. So, no matter what, listen, aliens on television and the government telling us what we need to do and church leaders falling and churches, whole denominations just giving over to Satan, and you can see some of the craziest things happening that you just can't imagine. And in the midst of it all, you must be able to say, on your own, I know that my Redeemer lives.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know what I see. I know what you're telling me. I know what I hear. I know what I perceive. I know. But I know that my Redeemer lives.
Hallelujah.
And I know in whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep
Amen.
What I've given to him. He's able to keep what he has taken into the heavenly realms beyond the veil. My anchor, my secure, my sacred anchor holds no matter what. Look, if you're not there, or if you just need to be, if you need a recommitment, if you need to restate that. If you just need to have a Gethsemane, I'm going to invite you to come here to the altar. I'm going to invite you to come and meet me here at the altar. Let's just take a few minutes to pray.
Yes.
To settle this.
Yes.
Listen, I know there's some really crazy things out there, and I know that there are some crazy things that are coming. I know what it looks like. I know it, but I'm going to trust my Savior. I'm going to ask you to come and meet me here at the altar.
Yes.
And just say, Lord,
I come to Jesus.
I need to get this right.
Yes, Lord.
I need to pray through.
Oh, Jesus.
Lord, in truth be told, my faith is a little weak.
Yes, Lord.
I've seen things, Father, that have shaken me. I hear things that are told to me that could contradict the things that I believe. They have proof, they have evidence, they have science. There's the multitudes of people all going down that road, and here I am. And I stand alone, Father, and I don't know what's true anymore. I don't know what's real anymore. And I hear, Father, things I see on television. I hear things that frighten me. Lord, I don't want to face the world. I don't want to face these things that are coming. God, I don't know what to do.
Yes.
Church, it has never been more... I don't do this for drama. It has never been more true. We need to know beyond our understanding, beyond our reasoning, beyond the evidence, beyond the proof. We need to be able to know that no matter come hell or high water, hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, fires, deception, lies. Lord, even though my life be threatened, if they threaten to arrest me and put me in prison, I will not change my mind. Lord, if I'm beaten, I will not change my mind. No matter what, Lord God, I know you are truth.